It's daily life, and it's getting warm. 98. I think it's only 10 o'clock. Feels great. I have the opportunity to work in the ministry and to do a lot of work on the internet, so a lot of times it is almost a relief to come out into the warmth of the sunshine and the weather, because sometimes the comments and the things that are said about people on the internet aren't as warm as what God has provided for us to enjoy, which is the sun, the rain at times, sometimes even the challenging remarks that people post on the internet. If we really held to truth, the fact is we are all accountable for the words we say, for the things we write, and for the actions we do, because God is going to try us to see if our hearts are being moved in the direction that He is, or are we moved by the direction that we think we're righteous in. And I hate to say it, but there's a lot of people that sure like to come off on the righteous side rather than where Jesus is at, because they want to confront for some reason. And I suspect that the idea of confrontation isn't one to go in the right direction, but to make them more like themselves. And sadly, God didn't create us all to be exactly the same. He made us uniquely and distinctly different. In daily life, in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. He was numbered with the transgressors. Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. By one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. This man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For as much as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. Because Jesus died, it ought to be enough to cause us to stop sinning. It doesn't. It ought to be enough to recognize that by what he suffered for our healing as well as for our salvation, even in watching movies that graphically depict it, it should be enough to cause us to quit being selfish or self-centered, but it isn't. In all these things, there's only one way that we can ever turn truly to Jesus and accept his salvation and, as the fancy word says, propitiation for our sins, and that is simply by faith, by just saying thank you and constantly remind ourselves that because he died, we live. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can you except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. The fruit of the Spirit is love. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love. Even as I kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. God commendeth his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in God, he that loveth dwelleth in God, and God dwelleth in him. Never have I seen in any place when God says God is love, have I ever once heard the example of that we should not love sinners and we should not love the ungodly, or that we should not love even those that we think we don't agree with. I have never seen that, because God is love. And yet I find in the attitudes, the actions, and the intentions of people when they separate themselves and point fingers and wag the tongue against some other leader or some other person that God has chosen salvation for, that they should somehow criticize them and be critical with a spirit that causes them to be angry and to be overtly separatist, to say that they are able to separate themselves and to say that that person is not saved in some way, that they are somehow God, and they can make that determination by way of saying, oh, well, I have the scripture, so I can make that decision. God help them. They don't know what they're doing. God is love. And if God has given us the ability to love others as the Father has loved the Son, and the Son has loved us, and we're supposed to share that love with the brethren, then I don't see how we are separating ourselves and causing divisions and angst and anxiousness in the body of Christ, even though we live in the latter days and there are those that go astray. Rather, let us see that if the gospel is there, whether we understand it in the way that we want it to be for ourselves, God is in control. Let God be God, and let man be man, and let us love as the Son of Man has taught us to, and Jesus said we should, because there is nothing that the disciples were told to do as far as setting up a kingdom of their own. It is rather a kingdom that God said is love, and that we are called to love the world because Jesus gave his life for it. To love the world of those that are in it, not the world itself and its ways. Because when we do, then they shall know that we are disciples and that we have love for one another. When you don't, you aren't his. The sad part, how many of us, when we think we're separating ourselves unto God, are separating ourselves from God? By love shall you know the truth.